which is totally fine, but we want to get started on time so that everybody can get out of here on time. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Dr. Heather Smith. I'm glad you're here. This is Dr. Marley Smith. We are health and wellness experts that specialize in the spine and nerve system. I want to start off by just recognizing every single person in this room. We've got a really varying degree in here. We've got some practice members who have attended a ton of our workshops that just always come. We've got practice members who this is their very first workshop. And then we've got guests in here. I especially want to welcome the guests. And then I just want to recognize every single person in here, because I know with all those varying degrees of differences, you all have one thing in common, and that's that you are action takers. And I tell you guys this every single time, but we love action takers because they always get the best results. It's the people who are coming to these extra events that we put on and want to know more about health and optimal health and how to achieve it that always get the best results. So I do want to recognize you all for being here, because we think it's awesome and there's no better place you could be right here. We truly believe that. Finally, I want to kind of just tell you a little bit about myself and about Dr. Marley, because for the guests in here, can we get Linda an extra pork, please? So, for the guests in here, whenever I'm at a workshop or a class or seminar, can't break that one, I always feel like I get more out of the message, if I kind of know the messenger. So, I just want to just introduce you guys to my little family here. So, first and foremost, Dr. Marley and I are parents. And that's literally these two girls, Nora and Quinn. They're our reason, they're our purpose. I'm sure every parent in this room understands what I mean when I say that. But they truly keep us driving. They keep us waking up every morning and lots of times through the night. I'm sure you understand that too. So parents first. Now, we're chiropractors second. So by that, I mean, and all of our patients in here, they know that chiropractic is not just what we do, it's literally who we are, okay? We want people to understand that we live out the lifestyle that we preach. We promise to every single patient that we are doing the things that we recommend that they do, because we think it's important to seek out healthcare practitioners who actually follow their own advice, right? If you go to a dentist with a set of false teeth, are you gonna trust them on what to do with your teeth? Probably not, right? So we truly take that very serious, and we try to be really good examples of the healthcare model that we preach. So chiropractors second. And then third, I like to just share with people the mission of our office is to educate, empower, and adjust as many families as possible on their journeys towards health and wellness, okay? So thank you for being here tonight and helping us live out our mission, all right? Now finally, Dr. Marley and I have been doing these talks a lot, and we've noticed a pattern. And the pattern is that people who engage more get more out of the talk, believe it or not. We don't believe that. So I like to equate it to two people at the gym, right? There's one person in the gym that's busting their butt, lifting hard, working hard, running hard, sweating and panting. And then there's one person at the gym, we all know him, her, that sits and like socializes the whole time, right? Just hangs out with their buddies and chit-chats and does a set of biceps and then leaves, right? Who gets the better workout? The person who's working out hard, right? So we truly ask you guys to be that person tonight. Work out hard with us, engage with us, interact with us, because you're gonna get so much more out of this talk if you do it that way. All right, guys, now without further ado, Dr. Marley is pumped to get up here and talk about inflammation. So I'm gonna let the sun up and come on up here.
So I got a question. First thing, is inflammation a good thing or a bad thing? Who thinks it's a good thing? Raise your hands. Okay, who thinks it's a bad thing? Okay, who thinks maybe it depends? All right, you didn't know there was a third option, right? So, when we have acute inflammation, let's say somebody sprains their ankle.
I'm just gonna say one way or the other. Perfect, okay.
If somebody sprains their ankle and they have acute inflammation, is that a good thing or is that a bad thing? It's a good thing. So we're drawing immune cells to the actual site of injury so we can heal that injury, right? We sensitize pain receptors so our body's told, hey, don't move this ankle, it's injured. And then it swells up, right? So we have decreased range of motion. So in that instance, that inflammation, that acute inflammation, super awesome thing. Body is brilliant. That's not what we're going to talk about tonight. Okay, we're going to talk about chronic, low-grade, insidious inflammation that most of us unfortunately are walking around with, and it's perpetuating and it's promoting many different chronic illnesses that we see in our society. So I want you to take a look at all of these conditions up here, and all of these conditions, What's one thing they all have in common? What's that?
They hurt.
Some of them might hurt, right? But there's one underlying thing that they all have in common.
Inflammation.
You got it. All right. So every single one of these conditions that we went over, multiple chronic illnesses, have a level of inflammation associated with them. And we have multiple different drugs, right, for inflammation. So all of these drugs here, you know, what's their goal or what's their target? What are they trying to do with these drugs?
Ease the pain.
Right, ease the pain, reduce inflammation, right, or inhibit inflammation altogether. My question is, do they do anything to correct the cause of the problem? Okay, are they just a band-aid? Are they just covering up the symptom? Okay, so they're never ever going to do anything to make us healthy, and they're never going to do anything to correct the actual cause of the problem. So what we want to do tonight is we're going to talk about the causes of inflammation and what we can do to limit them. So whenever we look at any disease process in our clinic, we come from the philosophy that there's two different things that can cause illness, right? Either a toxicity or a deficiency. Okay, so if somebody isn't toxic with something, it means they're coming in contact with something they shouldn't come in contact with. Now, that could be poor food choices, it could be chemicals, it could be social stress, right? You could have a toxicity in emotional stress. Or it could be a deficiency. You need something that is required for health. Okay, so it could be nutrition, it could be a proper nerve supply, right? It could be movement, it could be exercise, all right? So when we look at inflammation, the four domains that we're gonna cover, which is gonna sound a lot familiar to a few people in here from last month, is diet, exercise, thought life, sleep life. And these are the exact same things that created that hormonal storm that we talked about that promotes weight gain, right, and fat gain. Where we're gonna focus our attention tonight, guys, is diet. Because unfortunately, that's where the most people are confused. And we'll find out that's where the greatest need is. Right? So we're going to spend all of our time on diet tonight. And when we look at diet, everybody, and our food choices, unfortunately, 80% of the foods we consume are these. So, refined carbohydrates. Now, when I say refined carbohydrates, I'm talking about flour, right? Refined flour, refined grains. So I'm talking about your baked goods, your crackers, your cookies, your cereals, all of those types of things are refined carbohydrates. For this discussion, we have a fancy term. We're going to call those carbohydrates garbage, right? Because they're carbs and they're garbage, okay? And they're creating an unpleasant inflammatory cascade in our body. So 40% of what we consume, grains and sugar, okay? The other 20% that we consume is refined oils or industrial seed oils, right? And you don't know that you're consuming them, but if you're eating any packaged food, you're getting those refined industrial seed oils. All right? And then we eat grain-fed meats. And we went over last month how grains can actually contribute to weight gain and lock us in the fat storage mode. And it does the exact same thing to animals. And when we create a fat animal, what part of consuming that animal is healthy for us? Right? We know that an obese human is not healthy. Why is an obese animal healthy? Okay? So, all of these things cause inflammation. We're going to deep dive into them, but other things that trigger inflammation are gluten, trans fat, okay? Excessive emotional stress and lack of sleep and lack of exercise are going to promote inflammation as well. So, I know I'm not the most artistic person. I'm going to try and make sense of this, but we're going to dive into some chemistry here. So when we consume refined carbohydrates, this garbage, right, our sugar and our grains, our refined flour, what happens is we increase our blood sugar. And last month we talked about how insulin is released and brings glucose into the cell and it can lead to fat storage eventually. But I've left you guys hanging at that. When we actually bring glucose into a cell, we have to break it down further for energy. And in that process, we create a chemical called adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, and that's energy for the cell. But in this process, we also create some waste. We create free radicals. Okay, so has anybody heard of a free radical? All right, good thing or bad thing? Now you're afraid to answer, right? So free radicals are bad, right? And what free radicals are they're molecules with an unpaired electron in the outer ring. So they're very highly reactive. So they can go around throughout the body and react with other molecules, stealing electrons from them, leading to cell damage and cell death. So we really want to control free radicals. When we eat the foods that we're genetically designed to eat, they're also packed with antioxidants, right? So if you eat an apple, you're going to develop, or you're going to make ATP, and you're going to produce free radicals, but at the same time, there's plenty of antioxidants in that food to neutralize those free radicals. Does that make sense? When we consume sugar and refined grains, we do not have those antioxidants. Okay, so we produce an excessive amount of free radicals. Here's what happens. When we produce free radicals in the body, what it does is it triggers a signaling molecule. This puppy right here, which is going to trigger an entire cascade of inflammation. What this molecule is called is it's called nuclear factor kappa B. Not important that you know that. But what you need to know is sugar and grains turn this thing on. And it can turn on over 400 different inflammatory proteins. Okay? So once this thing's turned on, it triggers the nucleus of a cell to make these proteins, to create inflammatory cytokines, we call them. And then it triggers the liver to produce C-reactive protein. Now, has anybody ever heard of C-reactive protein? So if you get a blood test and you're looking for inflammation, that's what they're going to look for. They're going to look for this marker. Okay. So if we are over-consuming sugar and flour, we're going to produce an excess amount of C-reactive protein. Okay? We're going to literally be bathing in a sea of inflammation. And a normal level for C-reactive protein, we want that to be below 1. The majority of individuals are at least 1.5. Quarter of the population is 3. Okay, so you actually have those markers or those numbers on your sheet tonight, which will help you. Here's the problem. You can say, okay, I don't consume the grains. I don't consume the sugar. I know this, doc. But in all reality, the majority of people do. We're confused on what we should eat. And we might think that we're getting a healthy snack, right? Something like this Belvita. And we understand that there might be some sugar, there might be some grains in there. What we don't know is there's also industrial seed oils in there. And what I mean by industrial seed oils, I'm talking about your sunflower oil, your safflower oil, your canola oil, your vegetable oil, your soybean oil, your peanut oil. All of those are industrial seed oils. And they come in these packaged foods. It's 20% of the foods that we're actually consuming. So when we eat these industrial seed oils and these grains, what also happens is we produce a molecule, or we produce a compound in the gut called lipopolysaccharide. Okay? So we have bacteria in the gut. Everybody knows that, right? And we have gram-negative bacteria in the gut. When they come in contact with grains and refined oils, they produce a compound called lipopolysaccharide. And it's an endotoxin. So when this gets into our bloodstream, we have low levels of endotoxemia. Okay, so we literally create a toxic environment, and once again, we flip on this little switch and we trigger nuclear factor kappa B. And we release all of these inflammatory cytokines, stimulates the liver, we release C-reactive protein, and we have this low-grade insidious inflammation that promotes and contributes to every single chronic illness under the sun. Okay? It gets worse, right? So these grains, these industrial seed oils, they're high in omega-6 fatty acids, okay? I promise this will get a little easier in a second, but I just want to show you there's a process here. When we eat foods that are high in omega-6 fatty acids, we see this cascade. So we understand that we have different fatty acids that we need and require for health, okay? The body needs them, and we need to consume them. Omega-6 fatty acids are one of them. Omega-3 fatty acids are another one, okay? They're both good. But what we want a balance of the two, okay? We want a balance of about 1:1 to 4:1 omega-6 to omega-3 in our diet, all right? The typical American is eating a diet that is about 20:1 to 30:1, okay? So we get a lot of omega-6s and not enough omega-3s. And what this does when we eat these high omega-6 foods, we get them in the form of linoleic acid. Okay, once again, not important. This linoleic acid gets converted to gamma-linoleic acid, which gets converted to dihomo-gamma-linoleic acid. Not important, okay? I'm sure all of you already knew that anyway. This enzyme right here, though, delta-5 desaturase, turns this into arachidonic acid. So what we do need to know is when we have a diet high in omega-6 fatty acids, we produce a lot of arachidonic acid. And when we produce a lot of arachidonic acid, we start producing these inflammatory eicosanoids. Okay? And then once again, it contributes to inflammation, pain, and chronic illness. All right? I got a question. Do you think they have a drug to inhibit this process right here? Oh yeah, they do. Ever heard of it?
Eliminated or hide.
So what it'll do, it'll actually inhibit the enzyme that makes this reaction take place. Yep, they do. Ever heard of a COX inhibitor? So that's what this does. Or let's say a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, like an aspirin. Yeah. Inhibits this right here. Or what about something like Singulair, right, for allergies? It inhibits the production of these leukotrienes. But my question for you guys, what was the real problem here? When we look at this entire cascade, what caused this inflammation, pain, and chronic illness?
Imbalance.
Was it this? Was it the omega-6, omega-3 fatty acid imbalance? So was it the refined oils and the refined grains? Okay, so when we look back at this reaction, do you think they have a drug to inhibit this process right here? Oh, sure they do. They do. What was the cause of the problem? Right, did it have to do with the industrial seed oils producing the lipopolysaccharide? And when we look at this, same thing, they can inhibit this process from happening. But once again, the cause of the problem was the sugar and the garbage. Okay? So I'm going to get on a little soapbox here. Okay? Do they still do DARE in school? The Drug Abuse Resistance Education Program? Okay. I'm a fan of DARE. I think it's awesome what they're trying to do. What I'm going to say is it's never, ever going to work. Okay? Because we ingrained in these kids from the beginning of time that it's okay to take a drug when you're uncomfortable. And we actually give them drugs when they're still in the womb. So we're told that there's multiple drugs that are okay to take during pregnancy. I'm going to tell you there's no drug that's safe to take during pregnancy. For the longest time we were told Tylenol was okay when you're pregnant. And now there's tons of research coming out that the consumption of Tylenol and hyperactivity in kids, there's a huge correlation there. All right? And when we look at birth in this country, right, over a third of them are C-section, right? So they use drugs in that scenario. When we look at a supposed natural childbirth, over 50% of those people actually have epidurals or some type of drug intervention. Right? And when we look at this, when we look at epidurals and we look at the local anesthetic to that nerve plexus down there, the research is real ambiguous of whether that affects the baby or not. And we're not sure. And the other thing is typically they're laced with opioids. Okay, so your Demerol, your fentanyl, your morphine. And that does get to the baby. And if you don't think so, you can just watch a natural childbirth versus a typical hospital childbirth, and you're going to see a huge difference in that child. And many times as soon as that child's born, they might take it away and give it certain antibiotics or ointments, etc., in the eyes, right? So we are giving these kids drugs before they ever even enter this world, right? And then when they get sick as a child and you take them to the pediatrician, what's the solution, right? They got an ear infection, here's an antibiotic. If they're teething, go ahead and give them Tylenol, right? We don't want them to be uncomfortable. And then when they don't sit still in class, what do? We give them a label and we give them a drug. When really, they're just not designed to sit there in class for that long, they're designed to move. And then for some reason, we are surprised when they get into high school and their girlfriend dumps them and they didn't make the basketball team, we're surprised when they experiment with recreational drugs. We're surprised when they start smoking dope. When we've ingrained in them from the beginning of time that it's okay to take drugs, that when we're uncomfortable, here's a drug. It'll take away your pain. It'll take away your symptom. All right, so I'm going to say this will never, ever work, unfortunately. I like the idea, but if we continue this philosophy with our kids, we're in trouble. Okay? There's my soapbox. I am off. All right, so when we look at inflammation, when we look at the disease process, I love what Dr. James Chestnut says about this, huge wellness expert in our field. He says there is no such thing as pathology, okay? Illness, sickness, suffering, disease. He said pathology is mythology. It's adaptive physiology, right? So we were put on this planet to do two things, right? Survive and reproduce. So our bodies will always create a physiologic change to either survive or reproduce. are to survive long enough to reproduce. All right? Now let me explain. Let's say you are stuck on an iceberg. All right? Your body is going to create some changes that are going to hopefully allow you to survive long enough, right? Or not die. So what's going to happen? You are going to shunt blood from your extremities right to your core. So we can keep all of these vital organs alive because they're really important to survive. Now my question for you, if we stay in this situation long enough, is it possible that we can develop frostbite and gangrene and eventually maybe we'll lose a limb or a toe, right? And do you think that the pharmaceutical company is smart enough to where they could probably come up with a drug to reverse shunt blood and take any blood from your extremities, from your core and shift it back to your extremities so you don't get gangrene and lose a limb? They're smart enough. They could probably figure something out. And is the medical profession smart enough where they could probably come up with a contraption or an instrument where they could do the exact same thing? Mm-hmm. Probably. What does that do to help this person live longer? Nothing. So you can get rid of their symptom, you can get rid of their gangrene. The only thing that's different is now they're going to die with their foot as opposed to losing it. Right? So what we want to do is we want to try and figure out, all right, what's the body trying to do here, and what's the cause of this problem? The cause of this problem is this guy's environment, right? If he stays on this iceberg, he's going to eventually die. And his body is buying him enough time to get the heck off of the iceberg, all right? That's what we got to do. Change your environment, change your lifestyle. It's not going to come in a drug. So I got to get off on a little tangent again here. What do you guys think these numbers represent?
13.
What? Okay, I'll give it up. Right. I'll give you a hint. It has to do with death. It has to do with death in females.
Heart disease.
There's one of them. Which one do you think is heart disease? When we look at all the deaths of women, which one do you think is heart disease?
One in three.
Okay, I'll give you a hint. One is breast cancer, one is heart disease.
First one's breast cancer, second one's heart disease.
You got it. Okay? So out of all the deaths that we see in this country, one out of 31 in women is breast cancer. One out of three is heart disease. Okay? So heart disease is literally the number one killer in this country for males and females, and it takes more people from us than all cancers combined. Every single year. Don't get me wrong here, I am sensitive to breast cancer. I've lost an aunt to breast cancer. Dr. Heather's lost her grandmother to breast cancer. So I mean, no disrespect here when I say this. But do we have a lot of advertisement and promotion for breast cancer and trying to figure out breast cancer and treatments for breast cancer? To the point where we have athletes that dress up in pink cleats and pink uniforms, right? And we donate tons of money to actually try and figure out what's going on with breast cancer. When in all reality, we're losing way more people to heart disease. Right? I'm going to tell you both of these have an inflammatory component to them. And inflammation is helping promote that. Alright? And when we look at heart disease, it is 100% an inflammatory condition. And it's taken one out of three women from us when we look at deaths. 43 million women suffer from cardiovascular disease. So, what I want to do is I want to dive into that a little bit. Yes, I have another trick question. Do we have good cholesterol?
Yes.
Okay. Do we have bad cholesterol? Okay. I'm going to tell you that both cholesterols are good. We have physiologically appropriate cholesterol. So we're always told LDL is bad, right? HDL is good. I'm going to tell you they both serve their purpose and they're both very, very important. All right. In fact, the liver actually produces LDL, and without it, we would die. All right. So when we look at cholesterol, we, for some reason, it has been outcasted. It has been a villain. But when we look at the functions of cholesterol, it's hard to say that there's anything in the body that might be more important than cholesterol, except for your nervous system. Okay. So when we look at cell health, every single cell in our body is surrounded by a layer of fat. That fat is cholesterol. It's very, very important for the integrity of our cell membranes and communication back and forth from cells. It is important in, you cannot be a man and you cannot be a female without cholesterol. Okay? It's responsible for the production of our sex hormones. All right, testosterone, DHA, aldosterone, all the byproduct of having adequate levels of cholesterol. When we look at vitamin D, right, vitamin D, the research on vitamin D is unreal. It is so important in cancer prevention, in immune function, for bone health, right, heart health, controlling diabetes. We cannot form vitamin D, which we make it in our body when we're exposed to the sun. We cannot form vitamin D unless we have adequate levels of cholesterol. All right? Digestive function, we can't make bile, right? We can't absorb certain fat-soluble vitamins without cholesterol. Cholesterol is anti-inflammatory and antibacterial. In fact, they used to treat certain infections with things like egg yolks way back in the day, okay? Because of the antibacterial properties of cholesterol. And LDL and HDL both remove endotoxin from the bloodstream. Right, so remember we talked about lipopolysaccharide and how it creates an endotoxemia. Cholesterol actually grabs that and kind of recycles it. Okay, it clears it from the body. Important in creating a normal symbiotic relationship with our gut bacteria. All right, it is important in neurotransmitter function. All right, so you see the list goes on and on. It's important in the production of serotonin, which has implications in depression. Right, do we see a lot of serotonin reuptake inhibitors being prescribed, right? Antidepressants, anti-anxiety medication. The brain, right, is 60% fat. Right? It has a ton of cholesterol. Our nervous system, our nerves are actually surrounded by fat and cholesterol. That's how they actually conduct, right? Breast milk, high in cholesterol. Will the body ever produce something that was toxic to that child? No. Okay. And our bodies actually produce cholesterol. And it's needed and required for health. And there's no link, if you look at the research, if you really dissect the research, there's no link between saturated fat and consuming cholesterol and your blood levels of cholesterol. Right? So if your doctor is telling you to get on a low cholesterol diet for your heart, he's about 15 years behind the research. And you need to find a new primary care physician, okay? Because there is no correlation. In fact, when we see the body actually prefers the cholesterol that the liver produces. And the cholesterol that we actually consume, most of it gets excreted in our stool, right? So no correlation there. When we look at heart disease, it is 100% an inflammatory condition. So there's two things that have to happen, all right? We lose nearly 1 million people every single year from this one condition. So it's important that we dissect it. When we consume garbage, okay, these highly refined grains, these sugars, as well as other toxins, what they actually do is they circulate in our bloodstream and they nick and they scar our blood vessels. All right? So do I get a comb? And Dr. Kelly, I don't have my comb. I was willing to sacrifice my body today for a comb
in here.
Okay? So if I took a comb and I was to sit here and I was just for the rest of this talk,
you
I was
just... Fork?
No. If I was just to scratch my arm here, right? Eventually, what would happen? I'd eventually bleed, right? I'd have an inflammatory response. Things would get red. Things would get puffy, right? We see the exact same thing happen in our blood vessels when we consume these high sugary, high refined grain foods and some certain toxins. So they're actually circulating our bloodstream, creating little nicks within our blood vessels. And then our body has to figure out a way to patch that up and heal, right? So has anybody ever heard of fatty streaks? If they look inside a blood vessel, they can actually see early signs of heart disease because there's little fatty streaks within our blood vessels. So what's happening as a result of the chronic irritation, we have chronic inflammation, we start attracting certain things to the blood vessel to actually patch it up. One thing that's really important in wound clotting is LDL, or cholesterol, all right? So we start to see this scarring, this plaquing, and this clotting effect within our blood vessels. And then what does that do? It actually narrows our blood vessel, right? So the body's like, I still gotta get blood to these tissues. So we increase our heart rate, we increase our blood pressure, which is gonna create more stress on those vessels, create more damage, and it's just a continual cycle. However, there's something else that happens. We actually mutate cholesterol. We actually mutate LDL and create a free radicalized, oxidized form of LDL that the immune system actually attacks when we consume all this garbage, okay? When we consume a lot of sugar. So cholesterol is normally very large, it's soft, it's buoyant, and it's anti-inflammatory in nature. Normally will not cause a problem. When we consume garbage to the point where we actually create metabolic syndrome, or we can no longer control our blood glucose, it actually triggers the liver to produce small, dense, oxidized, free radicalized LDL. And as a response, the immune system doesn't like this. And it attacks LDL, and if that happens in the blood vessels, we have an inflammatory response and what we call atherosclerosis. Okay? So in order to have this heart disease thing go on, we have to have the we have to have the refined grains and the sugar. And it creates an inflammatory response in the blood vessels. It wreaks havoc on LDL, and then we get the plaquing and clogging of an artery. That has to happen. It's all inflammation. So cholesterol is not giving people heart disease. What is giving people heart disease is the sugar and the garbage that we're eating, and the other inflammatory foods that we're eating. The other thing that happens is normally HDL, the good guy, which we've always recognized as good, under normal circumstances actually produces this enzyme called peroxidase, which prevents LDL from getting oxidized. That entire process is inhibited when we eat these foods. Okay? Heart disease, 100% lifestyle induced. So the World Journal of Cardiology recognizes this. The World Journal of Cardiology. They say coronary heart disease is an extremely complex malady, and the expectation that it could be prevented or eliminated by simply reducing cholesterol appears unfounded. And after 20 years, we should concede the anomalies of cholesterol hypothesis and refocus our efforts on the proven benefits of a healthy lifestyle. Okay? So we've attacked cholesterol, right? Are statins really overprescribed in this country? I think maybe they're like the second leading medication that we actually take. So I'm going to explain something here, and then I'm going to explain statins. I know this diagram is very, very scary. I want to explain that when we eat this garbage, what it does is we've got to produce energy. Okay, so we produce energy with what gets left over. We store it as fat, and we talked about that last month. We also produce acetyl-CoA, and we are going to convert that into HMG-CoA, which is going to be converted into farnesyl pyrophosphate, whatever, and it's going to produce this oxidized LDL and HDL, okay? So it's this garbage, or these carbs, that actually leads to this oxidation of cholesterol. And when we also eat these foods, we elevate insulin. We talked about that last month. Insulin actually activates and promotes this HMG-CoA reductase. So it speeds this whole process up, okay? So when we're constantly eating these foods, these refined grains and the sugar, it puts us on an accelerated path to mutate cholesterol. And that's the problem with heart disease, okay? So what I want to talk about is a few supplements that are actually going to help us limit inflammation. All right? But I have to give you a warning. We cannot use supplements in the same way that we use medication. Okay? That is not the way to help. So I can tell you, you can take red yeast rice, and it'll lower your cholesterol. And it does it through the same mechanism that statins do, but that's not the way to health. We gotta figure out where's the toxicity, where's the deficiency. When it comes to supplements, if you're deficient in something, by all means, let's make sure your body gets it, okay? But it's not a permission slip to continue the lifestyle that you've been living and then just take a supplement to cover up the symptom that's associated with that. All right? When we look at supplements, guys, quality counts. Is everybody on this bandwagon? Can you now buy a supplement like at a gas station? Okay?
Yeah.
Or any store you go to? So quality counts. And our goal here is we're trying to create sufficiency and purity in the body. We're trying to give the body the things that it needs and requires for normal health and function. And we want it as part of an anti-inflammatory diet. So here are the supplements I recommend. A high quality omega-3. And the best source you're going to get high-quality omega-3 is in a fish oil. And when we look at fish oil and omega-3s, the things that are important are this EPA and this DHA. Okay? That's where the benefit is. Naturally, we get them from small, fatty fish, grass-fed meats, right? Breastfeeding. But what happens if mom is deficient in omega-3s, EPA and DHA? Is baby getting all that EPA and DHA? Because that's what's important for those synaptic connections for our nervous system. That's what's important for brain development, are these essential fatty acids, right? So if we aren't getting them, we need to make sure that they are breastfeeding. I'm going to hold off and keep you guessing with flaxseed and hemp seed, because somebody always asks me about it. So I'm going to show you a diagram, and I'll show you what I think about flaxseed or hemp seed. Our goal here is balance, right? We want to get as close to 1-to-1 as we can, omega-3 to omega-6. So by supplementing with these omega-3s, we can balance out that ratio and balance out that inflammation. When we look at a fish oil, it should always come in the triglyceride form. So there's many that come in an ethyl ester form. That's not the natural form. If it comes in a phospholipid form, that's not the natural form. We want to get as close to that fish as we possibly can. So if I were to stand up here and just wring out a fish, and we got the oil out of it, that's what we want, okay? The form that that's going to come in is a triglyceride form. So we want to make sure it's triglyceride. Look at your purity, right? We want to make sure that there's no toxins. Where was it caught, okay? Was it used, was it sustainable fishing practices? And look at the cost ratio, your EPA and DHA. What are you actually getting? Those are what you want to look at, the EPA and DHA. And the normal ratio that we see in a fish is 18 to 12, which breaks down to 3 to 2. I don't know why they always say 18 to 12, but 3 to 2 is the normal ratio. If you don't have that ratio, then they processed it somehow, and it's not as close to that natural form as we can get. If your fish oil ever smells like fish, or you get those fishy burps, it's oxidized, it's gone rancid, it's bad, right? So, it might be a poor quality supplement. It might just need to be put in the refrigerator after you open it. But if you get these fishy burps, that's not a good thing. When we look at krill, right, is there a lot of marketing for krill oil? So when we look at krill oil, it does not have significant amounts of EPA and DHA. Those are the very important things. Krill oil should really be considered a more of an antioxidant. It should be a carotenoid supplement, right? Never in the history of our species have we survived on krill or have they been a staple in our diet. So I really just don't think we should be consuming krill, and it doesn't give us adequate levels of EPA and DHA. When we look at dosing, that's important. If inflammation is not a problem and it's part of the lifestyle, up to about a gram, 1,500 milligrams of a fish oil is fine. If you're struggling with some chronic illness and we know that you have high levels of inflammation, we got to try and balance that out the best we can. You might have to take up to 3 to 5 grams of high quality fish oil, okay? And remember, it's not a treatment, okay? So you might have inflammation, you might have pain and a chronic illness, but just taking fish oil isn't a treatment, okay? It's part of a lifestyle. So here's the science behind the fish oil and behind the omega-3 fatty acids. So I left you hanging with the flaxseed and the hemp seed, okay? They come in the form of this alpha-linoleic acid. All right, and so do much of our vegetation, and we need that, we require that. However, we can convert this alpha-linoleic acid to EPA and DHA. When we look at those foods though, it's not really very efficient. So if we look at flaxseed and you're putting that in your smoothie, the conversion to EPA is about 5%. The conversion to DHA, which is really important for brain health, is about 0.5%. So the conversion process is just not very efficient. We need to be getting this EPA and DHA from our grass-fed meats, our fish. If not, we need to supplement with a good fish oil or a good omega-3. EPA, DHA, like I said, very important for nerve system health, for brain health, but they actually produce anti-inflammatory cytokines. Good thing, right? And they promote normal physiology. The biggie here is when we look at this ratio of omega-6 to omega-3 fatty acids, and we look at this enzyme I talked about, this delta-5 desaturase, EPA naturally inhibits that. So then we don't end up with all this excess arachidonic acid, and we can prevent the production of these inflammatory eicosanoids simply by creating a normal balance. Pretty cool, right? What do you think actually stimulates delta-5 desaturase? Getting hit, it's a drug. It's a very common drug. Statins, right? That are lowering our cholesterol, they actually stimulate delta-5 desaturase. So they increase the production of these inflammatory eicosanoids. So is it no wonder that the number one side effect of statin drugs are chronic pain, chronic muscle and joint pain, right? And it's because they're stimulating this process. But don't worry, they got a drug to inhibit this. And then when they're constipated from that drug, they got another drug to fix that problem, right? So it gets quite silly. When all we really need to do is let's create a balance of this omega-3 to omega-6 fatty acids, starts with a really good fish oil. Vitamin D, all right? Are any of us getting any vitamin D this time of year? Right? Because normally we get it from the sun. So we're pretty much all deficient right now. And this is something that we need and require for health, and we should be supplementing with it. Vitamin D is involved in the modulation of over 1,000 different genes, and the research on vitamin D is unreal. They literally have an entire vitamin D council, right? Which is crazy to me, this one vitamin that our body produces on its own. So deficiency can manifest in multiple different ways. It can manifest as a heart disease problem, it can manifest as certain cancers, right? The research on flu prevention and vitamin D is awesome. If you want to prevent the flu, make sure that you're sufficient in vitamin D. Okay, you're going to be much more beneficial than a flu shot. Deficiency also leads to inflammation, right? There's a direct correlation there. So vitamin D is so important in our immune response, right? So important in the production of T cells. I don't expect you guys to know a normal immune response, but what you do need to know is we have a T1 response, we have a T2 response. We want a nice balance, right? Kind of with omega-3 and omega-6. When we are deficient in vitamin D, we have a high T1 immune response, typically. We favor that, and this is pro-inflammatory. We have a low T2 or T-regulatory response, which is anti-inflammatory. So when we take vitamin D or we're sufficient in vitamin D, we have a nice balance and it helps limit inflammation. When we actually consume vitamin D, it increases our levels of interleukin-10, which is a super important anti-inflammatory cytokine. Cool stuff. It has many other roles outside of this discussion, but what you need to know is we're all deficient unless you're getting some this time of year. So we need to supplement with a good recommendation, 5 to 10,000 IUs a day. Okay? If you go outside and you get a little pinkish, not to the point of burn, but you get a little pink, you're probably getting about 20,000 IUs, okay? So a very safe amount here. And when we look at blood tests, you can actually have this tested, all right? And it's a simple test. What you want to look for is this 25-OHD or 25-hydroxyvitamin D. Make sure it's over 50. If it's over 50, you're sufficient and pure in vitamin D, and you probably have a nice anti-inflammatory response as a result. Probiotics. All right. Once again, not a cure. There are so many people that have started a probiotic regimen, whether it's fermented food or supplementation, and they've seen amazing results with gut health and certain digestive disorders. Once again, it's not curative. All you're doing is you're restoring a normal balance that should be there. All right. So once again, not a treatment. What probiotics do is they lower the pH in the gut, which makes it unfavorable for nasty bacteria to develop in the gut. Right? Helps promote good bacterial balance. We have, a certain gene expression that happens here that promotes healthy, normal gut flora and actually suppresses the nasty bacteria that wants to invade our gut. It produces things like mucin, which is literally just mucus that helps coat the intestinal lining so that we can't have bad bacteria actually penetrate the gut lining or stick to our epithelial cells within our gut. They secrete things like defensins, which neutralize viruses, bacteria, and go fungi. Okay? Really important. They enhance tight junctions. So if you guys heard us talk on Eat Right or Die Young, we talked about gluten and how it can open up these tight junction channels and create leaky gut. When we consume probiotics and we have a nice balance of good bacteria within our gut, it enhances these tight junctions and prevents things like leaky gut syndrome. It has anti-inflammatory properties because it helps in the production of IgA, which binds to bad bacteria and does not let them seep through the gut and enter our bloodstream. Also produces or contributes in the production of interleukin-10, an important anti-inflammatory cytokine. Right? And it decreases this guy. Remember? He's like the root of all evil that starts everything. Once this nuclear factor kappa B gets flipped on, all heck breaks loose. Probiotics help decrease this or inhibit this process naturally, normally. And we want to make sure that we're feeding our good bacteria, we're feeding our probiotics with prebiotics, which normally come in vegetation that we're supposed to be eating. Okay? We need to take care of our bacteria. Did you guys know that we are literally more bacteria than human? We have more bacterial cells within our body than human cells. So we need to take care of it. And the research behind gut health and the health implications that it has is so amazing. We really, really need to focus more attention in this area. It's very important. And the foods that we're eating are destroying this normal balance. When we look at food choices, guys, season your foods. Any type of herb or spice is gonna have anti-inflammatory properties to it. Salt, is not an herb or a spice. It is a mineral, all right? So any of these things up here, ginger, turmeric, garlic, right? All of those things have very good anti-inflammatory properties to them. All right, so I want to share with you an experiment here. What?
He's trying to take a picture of all the spices.
Oh, if anybody wants my PowerPoint deck, just email me, I'll give it to you, okay? So, what they did is they did an experiment here, all right? And they took two groups of pigs, all right? And one group of pigs, they fed a whole bunch of meat, beef, fish, right? Up to about 2 pounds. And a whole bunch of vegetation, almost 13 pounds. So these pigs, they're eating 14 and a half pounds a day. That's a lot of food, right? In fact, that's probably what they were doing all day, to actually eat 14 and a half pounds of food. They took the other group and they fed them just grains, okay? 3.4 pounds of grains in a day. And here's what they found. In group one, after a period of time, they found that they had decreased blood pressure, decreased weight gain, decreased fat, and decreased inflammatory markers. 14 and a half pounds of food, and just 3.5 pounds of food, or 3.4 pounds of food. Okay, so these grains are directly contributing to weight gain, which we talked about, and they're directly contributing to inflammation and chronic illness. So the lesson here, guys, pigs can mindlessly eat an anti-inflammatory diet, so can we. Okay. All right. Who in here can go to bed a half an hour earlier every night?
Well,
I was gonna say half hour earlier.
You know what?
Maybe not tonight because I kept you late. But all of us could go to bed just a little bit earlier, right? But what the research shows is people that get 6 hours of sleep or less, their bodies release the same inflammatory chemicals as if they're fighting an acute infection. Mm. All right. We could all go to bed a half an hour earlier. Who could get 30 minutes of exercise in a day? We can all do it, right? Who gets 30 minutes of Facebook time in a day? We could swip swap, right? And when we look at exercise, it's a good promoter of interleukin 10, that anti-inflammatory cytokine. Okay, so let's exercise. Who can journal? Who can attend church, a social gathering, right? Get your emotional stress under control. That's going to have a huge impact on inflammation as well, right? However you deal with that emotional stress. So when we look at stopping inflammation, guys, here's the steps. When we look at the science, it's simple. We got to produce, or we got to prevent the production of this nuclear factor, kappa B. And how we do that? We reduce free radicals. How do we reduce free radicals? Add antioxidants. Eat your vegetables, especially your greens. Remove the grains from your diet. Remove the refined carbohydrates, the sugar. All right? We want to reduce this lipopolysaccharide, so have a diet high in omega-3 fatty acids, if not supplement. A diet high in magnesium, potassium, probiotics, prebiotics, CoQ10, vitamin D. Right? If this time of year, supplement with vitamin D. In the summer, get out and see the sun. Okay? Eat alkaline foods. So foods that are high in polyphenols and carotenoids, those are simply the chemicals in foods that give them the color. Right? They act as very potent antioxidants. Once again, remove the fast carbohydrates. We want to reduce adipose tissue. All right? So we talked about obesity a lot last month. And when we look at obesity, we talk about how it's a hormone problem. And what we didn't talk about is adipose cells. They're not just fat cells. The new research tells us that they're actually endocrine cells, and they're actually immune cells. Okay, so they secrete molecules, or they secrete compounds out of them. And when we look at individuals that are obese, their adipose cells, or their fat cells, actually secrete inflammatory chemicals. And when we look at somebody that's lean, they actually secrete a chemical called adiponectin, which is anti-inflammatory. All right? So we really need to reduce adiposity. If you want advice on that, we recorded last month's workshop, Healthy is the New Sexy, we can give you tips there. Right? Also, we want to stimulate interleukin 10, so exercise, vitamin D, probiotics, fish oil, monounsaturated fatty acids, so your nuts and your seeds, right? Things like avocados are going to have good monounsaturated fatty acids. Eat your saturated fats, okay? And if it comes from a grass-fed, grass-finished animal, don't worry about eating that fat. That's good fat, Same with conjugated linoleic acid. It's a natural trans fat that we see in grass-fed animals. And then things like green tea. And I will admit, chocolate has some anti-inflammatory properties too as well.
Dark chocolate.
Dark chocolate. Over 70% cacao. And so does red wine, and so does stout beer, but I can't sit up here and tell you to eat chocolate, beer, and wine. There's other health consequences to that. Okay? Here's the thing. You guys didn't really think that you were going to come to a workshop given by the spine guy and not hear anything about spine. Okay. So every day in the clinic, we deal with a condition called subluxation. Now my question, do Americans sit too much?
Yes.
Yeah, to the tune of 13 to 15 hours a day is what the research tells us. And usually it's in front of a computer like this for 8 hours a day, right? Yeah, it's good. That's really good. And then do we spend too much time on technology?
Absolutely.
Right, so we do this. So we spend so much time sitting, there's now a sitting syndrome. It looks a lot like heart disease. Okay, we spend so much time on technology doing this that we have a condition called tech neck and text neck, which is degeneration of the cervical spine. All right, do the majority of people have poor posture? Mm-hmm. I've been looking at you guys this entire time. Okay? Yes.
I'm just kidding.
What about poor sleeping positions? Right? What about repetitive motions in the workplace? What about awkward positions in the workplace? Have you ever seen a mechanic work? They might have to get in a position, a real weird position for extended periods of time. What about, do we have certain traumas in our life? Car accidents, sports injuries, slips, falls, right? Every single one of these things can damage the spine. Simply life, okay? We live a very toxic and deficient life that can jar our spine out of its normal, healthy alignment. That's what we call a subluxation. And in this process, we damage the soft tissue that surrounds the spine. Mostly the disc that helps, there's the cushion between our vertebrae, right? And when we damage this soft tissue, guess what happens? We have an inflammatory response. Okay, so we have inflammation. And that inflammation irritates the nerves that actually exit the spine. So all these little yellow things here, right? If we have chronic irritation in that nervous system, is that a good thing? No, does that nervous system kind of control and coordinate every single function in our body? So if we have this chronic inflammatory process because we have a subluxation, you can see how that could be detrimental to our health, right? But it doesn't stop there. Typically, we're going to have a muscle spasm associated with that, right? The body's going to try and stabilize that. And over a period of time, we're going to develop fibrotic tissue in the joint itself and develop scar tissue within the joint to the point where our spine does not move. Anybody feel like you got a segment in your spine that just doesn't move? You feel stiff? It's because you probably do, okay? So not only if we leave this thing undetected, uncorrected, does it create a degenerative process that we can actually see on x-ray after it's wear and tear, it actually triggers a stress response in the brain, all right? Let me explain. So 90% of stimulation and nutrition to our brain comes from movement. Now, anybody in here been to a nursing home? All right, have you ever seen that poor person that is confined to a wheelchair? Now, typically, they're going to have the most rapid physical decline, but they're going to have the most rapid cognitive decline, too. And I'm sure you guys can see that pattern. The reason being is because they're not getting motion. So 90% of stimulation and nutrition to the brain comes from movement. The majority of that is because of movement of the spine. The reason being, we have multiple different muscles, ligaments, tendons that surround the spine that keep us nice and upright, right? Every single one of these joints, you can see there's 24 individual movable segments in this spine. Each one of those joints, each articulation, has little receptors in it that tells the brain where our body is in space, right? And that is that fuel and that nutrition to the brain. If we have an area of the spine that's locked up, it's not moving because we have a fixation, it creates a stress response in the brain. The reason being is we have a barrage, a bombardment of noxious stimuli because of the tissue damage, because of the inflammation, because of the nerve irritation, and because of the lack of movement, right? So we literally have a toxicity of nociception or noxious stimuli to the brain. And we have a deficiency of proprioception or mechanoreception, which fuels and supplies the brain with nutrition, okay? Because we're not getting that normal movement. So the end result, clinically, what we see is we see stress physiology. When our bodies enter stress physiology, we have a heightened sympathetic state or fight or flight state. What do our bodies do? We prep ourselves for movement, right? So those are the changes that we're going to see. We either got to fight or we got to flee. So when we're chronically subluxated, we elevate our stress hormones, cortisol. We elevate stress catecholamines, epinephrine, norepinephrine. What does that do, or what's the implications in something like heart disease? Right? If we're stuck in sympathetic mode, doesn't it increase our heart rate? Doesn't it increase our blood pressure? Doesn't it increase our blood lipids because we need fast energy? Doesn't it increase our blood glucose because we need fast energy? And doesn't it increase clotting factors? Sounds a lot like heart disease, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when we're stuck in stress physiology, when we got that gas pedal slammed to the floor and we're in a chronic sympathetic state, what's that do to fertility? What's it do to our reproductive organs? And it shuts them down. When you're in a fight or flight mode and you got to fight or you got to flee, you don't need reproduction. What happens to your immune function? Right? It goes down. What happens to digestion? It gets downregulated. So do we have a lot of digestive issues in this country? We have a lot of immune issues in this country. Are we seeing a skyrocket in infertility in this country? Okay. So every single time we adjust, you guys, I want you to realize that we're having a positive effect on the brain. And we're creating a balance between the brain and the body and the brain, and we're normalizing that communication. Okay? We're taking the stress and irritation off of that nerve system, and we're letting off of the gas pedal. We're pumping the brakes, and we're activating that parasympathetic nerve system so you can rest and heal and repair. Every single time we lay our hands on you, we make that improve. Okay? So it's not just a back problem. When we look at subluxation, it's a health problem. Okay? We're normalizing your physiology and your nerve system when we adjust you. So, here is a very complex drawing.
He likes complex stuff.
Everything
I feel for you guys. People are sweating bullets.
There is a test. Yeah, the back side of that sheet, that's what's on there. You can't leave until you get an 80%. Anyway, no, here is the physiology involved with subluxation, the neurology involved. Okay, so it is very, very clear what we do in the chiropractic profession. And it has little to do with neck pain and low back pain. All right? So here's the thing, if there's any guests in here, all my practice members know that I always give a special guest or a special invite to guests, okay? Because you're here and it tells me that you're an action taker and you take responsibility for your health. So if you're a guest tonight and you're you